Crosby from the corner, twisting and turning, inside out, beautiful move, trying to get the shot on, he holds, he shoots, he scores! Absolutely!
The pitch, high fly ball, center field, it's hit pretty well, toward the wall, goal! Oh my God! And you're
on top! Roethlisberger gets a run to Rozier, Juju Smith-Schuster, off to the races, inside the 30, the 20, the 10.
Look at that logo. Look at that logo. I put on my favorite yellow Pittsburgh Sportsline shirt. Thanks to A1. Anthony Veltri made that 10-year logo. Guess what? We're getting close to our 11th year, October 11, 2011. Wow, I'm going to have to get a magic cake, 11 years in 2011. Wow. Hey, thanks for watching our live Pittsburgh Sportsline show in the BPTV studios right here in the municipal building of Bethel Park. Police stations to our right, mayor's offices are up above, our great library that Smokin' Jim's never gotten a book out of is right above us, and great to be there, great memories, so check it out. Thanks for watching us on Comcast 7, only in Bethel Park. Comcast restricts that. Verizon 32, you can see in Bethel Park and all the way from Nemacolin, Cranberry, all points in between in greater Pittsburgh area, including city of Pittsburgh. So thank you for watching that. Thank you for all the likes on Facebook, and thanks for watching Facebook Live. Nick, how long ago did you start us with Facebook Live? October, November?
Yeah, around there.
In that neighborhood. We'll check a date and look for a view of that somehow.
I'll get back to
with technology. Nick's going to work on it now because he likes to ask questions and I answer every one of his, and he loves to compete with me and answer my questions.
Yeah.
We now have 69-43, 57 more. I just met new friends at the Veterans Wellness and Homestead, and a few of them said they'd like our page. And I got to give a shout out to Ruth Ruschel, who lives in Bethel Park, and her dad, Smokin' Jim, doesn't know this, even though he's a huge Pirate fan, and he met with them to scam them for free tickets.
Oh, wow.
His name was Rick Ruschel. He was a great pitcher, and he's a great golfer.
Wow.
And I even had his baseball card.
I got a fun note for you, speaking of the Facebook Lives.
I guess we got an answer from Nick Callis.
The first one we did was on June 15th, 2021. Today's June 14th, 2022.
We'll say
that this has been a year since we've been doing Facebook Lives.
Where's one of the cookies? 1 year anniversary.
Yeah.
Facebook Live. And thanks for all of you watching that. We appreciate it. All right, I better cut down on some of this, but you know I'm the talking machine, so let me hit the tape here. A1's on one camera. New volunteer Corey is here. He's a local Bethel Park resident, and he has some camera experience. He's a graduate of Bethel Park High School, too. All right, look at that. Close up on Olive Oils Pizzeria, Hillcrest Shopping Center, 412-831-1900. Give Frank a call. Today, Frank Finera had my XL pepperoni pizza and the six-cut Italian or steak hoagie ready for me when I walked in the door. So I've been wasting extra time waiting till Smokin' Jim came in at 6:57. I was here at 5:57, so it was a good long wait. Had some good conversations with my volunteers here and gave the game plan. Great Italian food, great pasta, salads, desserts, you name it, they got it, all except the Italian ice. They don't have it this year, and we need it today. It's a hot, humid one out there in Pittsburgh. All right, we'll see how A1 does again. We'll see how this is framed with my shirt. Let's see how he does if it's another good close-up. Look at that framing. Pittsburgh Sportsline is right up there with it. We end each show with Stay Joey Strong. That's their phrase for the Joey Fabus Childhood Cancer Foundation. Poor Joey died at 8 years old from DIPG, a dreaded brain cancer. Once you're diagnosed with it, you die within a year. He died before his ninth birthday 7 years ago. The parents started the Joey Fabus Childhood Cancer Foundation, raised over $100,000. Their biggest event is the 5K 1 mile superhero run at Bethel Park High School in September, about the middle or third week of September. I filmed each show. There's superheroes there, and you donate money to help find a cure. Okay, a little discussion here in the studio. So check them out, and if you can, donate as little as a dollar. They accept anything, and look for their other events. Thank you. Next up, another 5013. This is going to blend in with my shirt. I'm a little worried. Well, we'll see how A1 does on the camera. There's a little lightness with the brochure. On my desk, it looks the same. Just saying. With Smoking Jim, he's been blind like Stevie Wonder, and he may even be colorblind. But, well, he wore sunglasses for a year here. Just saying. Oh, yeah. You must have missed it. But it happened. He had some eye troubles and had a couple accidents.
I was here for one of those.
Well, he didn't tell me. For all of you that are older that have had cataracts, Smoking Jim said, Mick, what would he say? Black people can't have cataracts.
I was trying not to be racial with it. I thought that's what you were going to say.
No, but that's what he said. We don't say that. But I had to beat him to the punch because he tries to get that in there. Bethel Park Historical Society Schoolhouse Arts and History Center. We've veered off the path a little. 2600 South Park Road, red and white trolley. You can't miss it. I used to ride on those from Dormont all the way into Pittsburgh when I worked my part-time job at Rouse Discount near Kaufman's. Way back in 1971, for all you young puppies out there. They do great things in Bethel. It's a 1905 schoolhouse, been updated from the basement, which was a coal furnace, all the way to the cupola. That's where a bell was housed, the original bell that went to the new high school, which is now a newer high school, and they got a brand new bell there. So we're all belled up here. Check them out. They do different events. They have an auditorium named by the Community Foundation, which I'm a trustee. There's a plaque up there that says it. Smoking Jim, you can check it out because now you can see again. No sunglasses. We're good. And they do a lot of great things in the community. They have different events and, you know, reunions, weddings, you name it. They do it up there. So check them out. Great location. Great place. Next up, another 501c3. It seems popular with what I do in the community. And the young kid Bennett is right there in here. You'll see it. A1's on fire. Look at that. Nice framing by my shirt there, too. You added that in there. He always was smiling. He was handicapped, needed two kidney transplants, not just one, but two. His dad, Dean, gave the second transplant, and they named Always Be Smiling is their 501c3. The B stands for Bennett. He was the happiest kid you could ever meet. They said always was kidding around, trying to do stuff. And at 16 and a half, he passed away a year and a half ago. And they help other people with kids that need kidneys. They give them money and things to get the transplants and the supply, different supplies and help they may need. So please keep liking them. And thanks to all of you for getting them up to about 1,200 likes. I appreciate all you. And so do they. They thank you. Next up, I had a social worker friend of mine say, I have a friend of mine that's having chronic kidney disease and may need a living donor. Can you help? I said, I'll talk to her. After talking to her, I talked her into, look at her. That looks great on TV. Kathleen looks as good here on the flyer as she did. Look at that action shot with A1. What's going to happen? Did you see that flip around, folks? Another Pittsburgh Sportsline first. She had kidney function of 17%. To get a transplant like I did, it has to be 15% or lower. She got a living donor by us putting this up each week. We don't know who it is until she gets her transplant. So hopefully she's hanging in there and as healthy as she could be. And we've got prayers for you, Kathleen, and we'll find out who the donor is when she gets a transplant. Next up, Bethel Park Community Foundation has money for you. There's that little pause. Look at that close-up. Nice work, guys. Dave Cable will be happy. The Bethel Park Community Foundation has grant money. $100 to $5,000. Go to bpcf.org. You know how to put the three W's in front of it, so I'm not going to educate you on that. We've all been doing this computer stuff for a while, since the 90s. Most of us, since we've been alive longer. For you younger ones, somebody will tell you. Get your money and do great things with it in our community, with the groups and organizations you're with. So contact them again, bpcf.org. All right, last little promo. We'll see what A1 does with this. I won't kid about Uncle Sam. We made enough fun of Smoking Jim tonight so far. Of course, we don't know what he's going to say. I want you for BPTV. You can be like A2, who's now filling in for Chip. Chip couldn't be here. Him and his wife just lost a cat of theirs. It passed away and died, crossed the Rainbow Bridge. They had a vacation planned for up in Connecticut to eat lobsters till they burst. Not the lobsters, just them. So that we'll eat a lot of them. And you can be like Corey here. You can be like A1. You can be like Ryan in there handling all the controls and audio. And he's even doing our special graphics, which you'll see in a couple minutes. And you can call 412-831-3304. Tell Dave Cable you're in high school and you want to learn about producing TV shows and see if you can get a career in that field. Anybody's more than welcome. These guys went to school at, we won't mention the college because Smoking Jim doesn't believe they give degrees out. And of course he went to Gateway and he said he got a diploma. I've known him for 11 years. Don't know anybody that went to school with him. Don't know where that diploma is, but you guys can get a diploma like A1 and Ryan and even A2. Can't forget A2. All right. That's my little promo. All right, where are we going here now? What's on your mind, Smoking Jim Frazier?
Thanks, Al Levine, the talking machine. And if you want the green,
Interference on Nick.
But I tell you what, I'm coming through the parking lot, and I see this Harley Davidson with all this chrome looking good. Fonzie didn't have that much chrome on his.
Whose bike is it?
It's Ryan's bike. I tell you what, Al, one day
don't get all choked up. Drink some ginger ale.
One day I'm gonna come in early so I can ride it around the parking lot. You gotta have a motorcycle license to ride that.
Hold
all
it,
that
wait,
around.
Wait. I gotta speak for Ryan because I always ask how he's doing. If he's doing good, he says yes. So on behalf of Ryan, if you wanna ride on the back,
I wanna burn a little rubber
after the show. Ryan gives you permission to hang on to him when he pulls out of the lot. He'll take you down to the entrance of our lot, and he'll push you off.
The way you drive, you could do a wheelie.
But I tell you what.
What?
I've been inspired by A2 and Ryan with their basketball, with Chip and the VIP, Nick with the Pirates, and Chip with the hockey, and of course, the captain with all sports. But Al Levine, the talking machine, you and I do a lot of stuff with combat sports. We specialize in boxing, and this is a great era for boxing. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about boxing. And matter of fact, I seen he don't like to be called Eric because he don't like his dad. He likes to be called Apollo. Apollo Eric Signor. Signor. I seen him yesterday at Dave and Buster's.
But Smoking Jim, your dad's name's James, and we don't know what your government name is, but you go by Smoking.
But he goes.
So I think you're like Eric.
Yeah, he don't like his dad, so.
That's what I think
I'm
you are.
I'm trying to remember to call
I
him
think you're like that.
But he was a great fighter.
He had the best smile of a boxer that I ever saw.
Still looks good.
And he's an artist.
Yeah, he does. He said he does tattoos and stuff, which is a great business.
Maybe you could get one from him for free. I don't believe with those compliments you're
telling. I'm the only black person don't believe in tattoos. But I just want to talk a little bit about boxing, Al Levine, the talking machine. This is a great time.
Hold it. Breaking news. Chip Hayner said, hello, or good evening, gentlemen. Hello from Southern Maine. Keep chewing on that lobster. Enjoy yourself. Thank you. Amy Sliss said, hello, guys. I got my hair color haircut today at Beautiful Hair Salon next to Bethel Bakery. Thanks, Amy. Ralph Williams, hello, guys.
My man.
Greg Kirby, my catcher from Little League. Hi, buddy. I had cataract surgery with multifocal lenses implanted 14, 15 years ago.
Wow.
My eyes were bad, too, like smoking gyms, and they're great now and will never change. And he's as old as me.
Wow.
And then Tony from Chick-fil-A, sorry to interrupt you, Jim, because you get off subject. We're trying to keep focused on you. So far, Greg got it. Now Tony got, tomorrow's going to be more hotter than smoking gyms sports facts. On that, we're going to go to Nick. Go ahead, smoking.
But I tell you what, the
Oh, yeah, and Pony League with Greg. That's right. I forgot. Thank you, my Pony League catcher.
The lightweight division is really heating up. There's a young man called Devin Haney who not only is this guy destined to be outstanding if he can hold the 135-pound weight division. El Avina Taco Machine, when he was a teenager, he moved to Mexico because
he wanted to be like Canelo.
Well, everybody should want to be like Canelo, but
without the red hair.
But in Mexico, you can be a young age and still turn professional. You got to be a certain age here in the United States. So he got a lot of fights in down there, and I tell you what, he fought an undefeated champion, and it's the first time the lightweight belt has been unified since Sweet Pea Whitaker, and he's been dead for years. He fought in the 84 Olympics, so you know how long that was. He went to Australia. El Levine, the talking machine, fought in this guy's hometown, beat him every round, and it was this guy's name is George Kambosos, who's an outstanding
You're
fighter.
You're doing good on your names tonight, buddy.
Yeah, I'm doing good on some of those
Haney
big
and
names.
Kambosos.
So remember that name, and remember the
Can you say it again?
Lightweight division, Devin Haney, okay. Outstanding young fighter.
Is that like Mr. Haney on Green Acres?
Sort of.
He might
but
be related
Haney
to
Mr. Haney was a slicer. He was
How
slick.
How do you know that?
I used to like when Mr. Haney came. He always had a good deal for you. But that's what's on my mind. Boxing is really up and coming right now. This is a great era for boxing, and you and I do a lot in the boxing community.
Well, I prefer the local because in the national, you can win one pro fight and get a belt. Those pros get those belts pretty quick.
In MMA, yeah.
No, UFC. I was talking boxing.
One fight, they get a belt?
Yeah, just research that.
Whoa.
You might have missed a couple dozen of them.
Yeah, heck yeah.
Yeah.
I missed that.
Just saying, buddy. Thank you.
Ouchie.
Nick Callis, what's on your mind?
Well, the Pirates are making me sad, so that's not shocking. Beat some good teams, give us some hope, and now they're not doing so well, and they're on a 8-game losing streak, so sadness there. Yeah, Smoking Jim's happy about
your
that.
Emotions,
I'm set.
Your emotions
no,
about
I'm
the Buccos
the
are on a roller coaster.
No, yeah, they are because, you know,
I'm just calling it like I see it.
I'm waiting for the season they break through, and I was like, maybe, but I think I was wrong early on. I mean, they're struggling right
there
now.
There you go, folks.
And this period of time, I'm just sad. I got that bipolar with the Pirates. It's not fun.
Not permanent, though, either.
Not
right?
permanent. I mean, okay. I'll still stay optimistic.
I'm wearing
my
Pirate hat.
They just should. The game against the Cardinals yesterday, and I'll go more into detail about that in my VIP segment because I got something to say. They shouldn't have lost that game. So that's tough.
Did they score more runs?
They actually outhit the Cardinals in that game. But they did not score more runs, so they ended up losing.
Yeah, because yes, I have to teach people that are new to sports. The easiest way to win is you score one more run.
Yes.
In baseball.
Yeah. Well, they had a 5-run lead, and they couldn't hold on.
In golf, it's the opposite. You want to score lower.
Right. That's
just
what
that they need to know.
Golf's the only
you
exception.
You brought it up.
That's
yeah.
right.
Yeah, just wanted to bring
so
it
that's
up.
My view on the Pirates. Also, have a little bit more optimism on the Steelers. I figured Deshaun Watson – wasn't going to play this next year because all the allegations that were coming out because they were serious and
they added two
was
more.
Going down. Yeah, now the Texans are involved in the lawsuit as well because the Texans might have given Watson a place to stay in these hotels where some of these inappropriate acts took place. So that's dramatic, interesting. But yeah, I figured early on that Sean Watson at least wouldn't play in year one, and who knows what's going to happen.
He got guaranteed money though.
Well, yeah, but they wanted to pay him as little as they wanted him to lose as little money as possible, so they made the later payments on his contract heavy. That's why they did that. Not saying he's not going to make money, but my point with this was that I still have optimism with the Steelers because I figured Deshaun Watson wasn't going to play. Baker Mayfield was excused from parts of minicamp.
The whole thing.
Yeah, okay, the whole thing. So, you know, he hasn't been around, so what the heck's going to happen with him? Who knows? So I still have more optimism with the Steelers because the Browns don't have a stable quarterback right now. The Ravens are on a slide, and the Bengals would be the only team to
Nick,
worry about.
Nick, I got to interrupt you with a question.
Okay.
Have the Browns really changed how the Browns are?
Nope, not at all.
Just that wanted to bring
signing,
that up.
And that signing made it. Watson doesn't want to play. Hey, we'll give you a contract where you can't lose. Okay, well, yeah, and then these allegations might cause you not to play for like maybe the first or second year, maybe even more depending on how serious these fall out. But like, yeah, the Browns are silly, and nobody should have feared anything because this is what happens. So I still have optimism for the Steelers. They've got a batch of quarterbacks who are unproven but also have more potential than the guy who's facing 24 and actually maybe even more now lawsuits against him as we speak because of
that. Isn't surprising.
I'm not surprised, but I know a lot of people were freaking out because they're like, Deshaun Watson's good, but he's in some legal trouble right now, so that's it's likely going to cost him at least the first year of his year.
You know, he made an offer to all the ones that were suing.
Yeah.
Did you hear that?
Yeah, but there are more lawsuits coming in.
No, but he made offers, and guess what they did?
Decline.
Every one of them.
Yeah. So
really?
Yeah, they're not going to settle. I mean, I guess this is more serious than settling.
We try to tell you the truth because for some unknown reason, you have other sources.
Oh, I wanted to mention that, too. Your bottle of ginger is little today. Yeah.
But my pirate hat is big.
Which one was free?
Huh?
Which one was free? Digester sandwich. Thank you, Nick Callis. We can see Smoke and Jim's true colors. They come out, and it's about green. And you know Levine knows green, so thank you. All right, we're going to go to A2.
What's on my mind is a little bit of NHL talk.
Yeah.
I'm kind of disappointed that the Rangers didn't beat the Lightning. Sadly, I know that they're rivals of the Penguins, but I'd rather have seen them because three-peats to me are a little boring sometimes, depending on the team. I like the Lightning. They're a very high-paced team, very good team. But I think it would have been nice to have the Rangers in, something new. And I was also disappointed that McDavid and them got swept, I'm pretty sure.
The NHL should be disappointed, right?
Yeah, a disappointing series, but the Avalanche are a very, very good team, very young.
Except for one thing. Goaltending.
They do have weak goaltending.
See, I knew I'd stump you.
I'm sure I think, yeah, but they are a very good high-scoring team. If you can't beat them, you have to beat them outscoring them. If they start scoring on you, they're a very dangerous team. Also, I also agree with Nick with the Browns. Sky's blue, grass is green, the Browns are the Browns, always terrible.
Wow. There's a true Pittsburgh young man. He was brought up on that.
But that's how the Browns are. Mm-hmm. The Deshaun Watson trade was just stupid. They should not have done that. That's going to be stupid.
Well, then, how about how corrupt they are? They skated the rules, and he doesn't have to worry about getting money till his second year.
Yeah.
Because the least amount in his contract was first. His first.
I mean, when you say things aren't corrupt, I see corruption just in that.
They were scary for a minute.
Well, no, Smoke and Jim, ever since they got Baker Mayfield, checked the tapes. He said he's the greatest quarterback he ever saw.
Look at you shaking your head like that's still true.
Well, he's an NFL scout and Steelers scout, so we're not sure whether he was just negative against the Steelers, but he loved Big Ben till he got old. Then he changed. He loved Mike Tomlin since he said something about him to get him mad. But other than that, Smoking Jim. Anything else, A2?
I agree with him in a sense that not Baker Mayfield is like the best of all time. I think that they still could have utilized him in some way, give him like another season. He was injured this season.
What are you clapping for?
He's making
give the
sense.
Man another chance?
He's making sense.
I'd say one more just to see what happens, and then they could have made a move. But
too late.
It's too late for that. They did the Deshaun Watson. That's what's on my mind. Browns are the Browns. NHL playoffs are exciting. Hope the Avalanche win.
Just to show you that A2 was asked about 5 minutes before the show. So this is all off the top of his brain. So he does know some sports, so thanks, A2. What's on my mind since A2 didn't cover it? I'll go NBA. I said Golden State. And who would think? Here's what's amazing. I watched the game. Curry missed threes. Got no threes in a game. 0 for 9.
Wow.
First time in 233 regular season and playoff games that he didn't get a three.
Wow.
And guess what? My new heroes, Wiggins. Wiggins played a heck of a game, scored 26, was rebounding, great guy. And they won, but you can't blame Curry for anything wrong. He had 8 assists, and he had, 17 points. So he was able to shoot. We all rate A1. We never saw you climbing around like that. It's been years since Tiger did that, Smoking Jim. We had that experience, but I'm with Golden State. They need one more win. They may have to win it on the road. And Draymond Green is, I didn't think he was sensitive to people yelling the F word at him and just abusing him a whole game. But whenever he's played in Boston, he was terrible. Before last night's game, he had, 15 points and 17 penalties. So that's not playing very well. He's not a big scorer, but last night he had about 5 points in the first quarter, so he was doing much better. But I'm for Golden State. That'll be the 4th championship they got in the NBA. I don't like to see the streaks like you, A2, but I respect the teams because they do it the old-fashioned way. They win, and I'm all about the winners. Enough of that. I'm not going to ramble on anymore. Go Golden State, whether you like them or hate them. I'm for them to win another one. And we're going to be back in 10 seconds with Fiction and Fact from Smokin' Jim's Almanac.
Thank you, Captain. Thanks, Al Levine, the talking machine. And I tell you what I'm going to do is I'm going to just stick with boxing today. Al Levine, the talking machine, a friend of ours, a friend of the show, Roy Jones Jr. got inducted into the Boxing Hall of Fame along with the phony man, Floyd Money Mayweather. He gets up there and starts fake crying. Not a tear come out, A2. I'm still waiting for the tear. Layla Ali gives him a hug. She should have knocked them sunglasses off his face. They give him some tissue. Not one tear come out. He's so fake and phony. But Al Levine, the talking machine, James Toney, who is punch drunk at this point in his career. But what a great career he had. A lot of people don't realize he knocked out Evander Holyfield in a heavyweight match at one time out of Detroit. And a lot of people don't know that Floyd Mayweather perfected, you know, his defensive stance, but James Toney had it before him. And the originator of it was one of my all-time favorite fighters. Jersey Joe Walcott is the originator of that, never gets any credit for it, but I'm giving credit
first
for
time
it
ever.
That.
First time
Jersey
ever.
Jersey Joe Walcott, one of my all-time favorite fighters.
Didn't he fight in Pittsburgh?
Jersey Joe Walcott knocked out Ezra Charles at Forbes Field to
He's
win the heavyweight
boxing history
championship
guy. How'd I do?
Of the world. You did right. And it was the next championship outdoor fight in Pittsburgh was when Ray Kovar Saunders won the cruiserweight championship at Heinz Field.
How many years later?
It was an empty Heinz Field. It was an outdoor elevated talking machine. It wasn't like Ford Field. I was there though. I could sit anywhere I wanted to. But elevated talking machine. What a tradition that Pittsburgh have with their great fighters. And I tell you what, Mike McSorley has a guy that I really like, the pit bull from the Ukraine, 135-pounder.
Ola Dovin.
So he's rated number 4 by the WBA. So I'm interested.
And doesn't he have Con Greb boxing? And Harry Greb was the Pittsburgh windmill. He fought anybody.
Yeah. And
another great fire. And Smoking Jim, when there were only 8 belts, we had 5 of them out of Pittsburgh.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So I know a little bit of history.
I'm going to read that book one day.
I don't think so. Doug Kavanaugh's a great author, and he knows you. He knows you.
And that's a little fiction and fact from Smoking Jim's Almanac.
Thanks.
A couple of them guys could really go to the liver.
I'll never forget that.
Jim Ellenbogen says, thank you, Nick, for putting together our show on gun control. A lot of great feedback. Many thanks. Jim Ellenbogen knows a little bit about sports. He says, Browns fans are waiting for the return of Leroy Kelly, Paul Warfield, Bill Nelson, Jim Brown, and wild-caught pros. You got to throw in my wild-caught. My cooking show is tomorrow, so stay tuned for my next wild-caught fish meal. All right, we're going to go to VIP time.
All right, here's the opinion about the Pirates.
Which one?
Still sad. The Pittsburgh Pirates, the baseball team, baseball club. Okay, so Mitch Keller pitched 5 innings, gave up 2 earned runs on Monday night and didn't get a decision, even though he pitched well. And he pitched to get pitched for the Pirates to eventually lose the game because Anthony Bonda came in and gave up some hits and a home run that eventually caused the game to get tied. And then Cardinals then eventually took the lead and won. So there's been some discussion about whether Mitch Keller is actually good now and he's going to do well. I heard on Cook and Joe this morning, though, them talking about how, you know, Mitch Keller always seems to pitch to do good enough for a loss. And it just seems like
that's interesting.
He's pitching well enough for the Pirates to lose. So that makes me think, you know, is Keller still not giving enough of an effort? Is it the Pirates as a whole organization that's the problem? Is Keller ever going to be the ace of the future that we thought him out to be? And here's my opinion on that. I really don't think he's going to be the ace of the future for the Pirates. I think COVID might have that year where the season was shortened and, you know, development was kind of weird and sometimes not happening for minor leagues. Weak. Development was weak because minor leaguers didn't play. There were minor leaguers that came up to the majors for the 60-man roster that they had that season, and Mitch Keller was one of those people and just never got the chance to really comfortably develop, and especially because everybody had like 2 months off when quarantine was happening. So that's kind of tough for anybody to develop in, but, you know, Keller struggled. He's been more off than on. I was going to say on and off, but, like, really, he has struggled. The big thing, though, the big positive, the big peak that happened yesterday, though, was the fact that he had developed his curveball well enough to get swings and misses. It had more movement on it, and it was more deceiving to hitters, so he was getting more swings and misses. And he was limiting the base runners from the Cardinals by mixing up his pitches with his high 90s fastball and then that curveball that was deceiving. So, but be that as it may, one good outing like that from him that we haven't seen before, I think he's got to prove himself more as the season goes on. But he's not going to be anything of an ace in Pittsburgh. It doesn't mean he's not going to be an ace somewhere else, because it seems that pitchers for the Pirates have gone other places in recent years and succeeded. So he could be one of those guys. I don't think that the Pirates are going to develop him well. I don't think he had a good start with the Pirates, and I don't think that the path he's going on right now is going to make him the most successful that he could be. I think that that game yesterday was, what's that? Oh, are you smiling?
No, what the heck happened to his finger?
Hang no.
Did you bite it while you're eating pizza?
Oh, no. Bring out the tape. Is that just tape?
I did it myself.
It looks like it. That's why it's noticeable. Yeah. Nice.
Smoking Jim had an accident. We missed it coming in. And I know he ate up that pizza so fast and hoagie. He may have bit himself. So carry on, Nick.
But yeah, I don't think that, like, that one moment, he's shown some promise, but something, the curveball moving like it did in the way he pitched yesterday, just seems like right now that's a peak, and he's only going to continue to go down or at least fluctuate from here. And that's kind of tough because, you know, again, he had so much promise coming up. It seems like that's a common theme now. You know, ever since Pirates had those good years a few years ago, now it's just a common theme where there's so much promise for a guy who has some flashes in the pan and then gets dealt off to go somewhere else and be a top pitcher somewhere else.
He could be one of our top six pitchers playing for other teams.
I'll still never understand why players are doing so much better outside the organization for the Pirates. But he's just one of those players where it's like, don't be fooled by that. Because at the end of the day, he pitched in a losing effort. And maybe it's tough to pitch for the Pirates as well. I mean, you saw Yu Chang on Monday. I didn't watch much of the game today because I was working here. But the game yesterday, I mean, Yu Chang dropped the ball. It was easy when he was covering first base on a bunt, which led to a run scoring. So, like, are the pitchers having to work a little bit harder because the defense behind them, the Pirates' defense, isn't, you know, doing the right things?
The answer is yes.
Yeah. Because that's a game that the Pirates should have won on Monday. Like, they should have snapped the losing streak. Five runs should be enough for any of for any team. But for the Pirates, it's not. And I'm looking at this and I'm thinking, too, like, well, are we technically in the third year? Or does this count as only the second year of rebuilding because, you know, COVID was shortened? Is this just the second
Simple
year?
Simple as that.
Is this the second year of the project?
I'm in charge.
This isn't what teams that, you know, are 2-3 years into their reclamation projects are doing. If you're going to put together a team, you can't lose games where you're winning by five runs in the middle innings. It can't happen, and that's just what frustrates me. Keller did a good job pitching in the early stages. He struggled in that sixth inning, and then the Pirates lost the lead. He pitched well enough to lose the game.
You made your point, but how many number one picks make it in any sport?
See, I don't know, because
I used the
Jameson Taillon analogy back in the wintertime. The number one pick of the 2010 draft was Bryce Harper. The number three pick by the Orioles was Manny Machado. In between them was Jameson Taillon, who had 2 Tommy John surgeries in his time with the Pirates.
And cancer.
I'm not going to bring up the cancer because that wasn't obviously his fault.
But he had it.
I understand. So he misses a lot of time, comes back, doesn't pitch well, goes to the Yankees. Now he's in the rotation. Clay Holmes is now the closer of the Yankees because Aroldis Chapman's on the injured list. How is this happening? Who knows? You've got to match. The pitcher's got to have good defense on the teams, and the offense did its job on Monday night, scoring 5 early, getting to the Cardinals, chasing their starter, and here we are. They lost by two runs.
I got one answer to your question.
Okay.
Did you guys talk about the Browns?
Yeah.
That's what the Pirates are.
The Pirates is the Pirates? Is that what we're going with? No, I don't like that. What's up? You're wearing a Pirate hat.
I like to answer Nick's question. Your question was, why guys who don't play well for the Pirates play well for other teams? And it's because of the Sid Breen curse.
But that was broken because the Pirates made the playoffs.
No.
After that happened.
Well, it's Smoking Jim.
Curse is still on.
Smoking Jim's an honest man, and he knows the Sid Breen curse started.
Guinness Book of World Records.
Who threw the ball from left field? Okay.
Wasn't Sid Breen. Barry Bonds.
Hey!
Now we got to the bottom of it. They only called it the Sid Breen curse a couple years later because a couple crybabies thought you had to blame somebody for a loss for an MVP guy not to throw a guy out at home who had 4 knee surgeries. But you don't go by the facts. So we're going to move on from VIP Nick. No rebuttal for that. We're going to take 2 with A2.
Basketball, NBA, playoffs going good. I predicted the Celtics to win this series in 6.
Oh, sorry to rub it in.
they have not done that. They are down 3-2 right now to the Warriors. The Warriors are playing really well. I do got to give credit to what Al said as well, to Andrew Wiggins. He's been playing phenomenal, especially last game. He's been playing the past few games. Well, the season, he wasn't that good.
Right.
He had his problems up and down. But the Warriors, I don't really mind who wins the series because they're both very likable teams. I enjoy the Celtics. I enjoy Jayson Tatum, Robert Williams, and Jaylen Brown. They're very good players. I hope to see them win a title in their near future. I do think the Warriors at this point might pull through. Steph Curry's at an elite level, except for this game. He missed every three they took. But other than that, he's still playing really, really well.
0-for-9.
0-for-9. Andrew Wiggins, a very interesting person because me and Ryan talked about him a lot years ago because he was also a former Timberwolf.
That's why I thought you'd relate to that.
D'Angelo Russell. So, and D'Angelo Russell right now is possibly might get traded from the Timberwolves. So that's very interesting. I don't know how to feel, though, but, yeah, NBA is going good. I think the Warriors might win. I don't know if they're going to win at Boston. They might. It really depends on if Jayson Tatum does good because he's been playing really bad recently.
Where's he go in the fourth quarter is what I want to know. Okay, just was asking.
Actually, Andrew Wiggins has been locking up pretty well in the playoffs, I will say. He's been doing really good against Jason.
You're one
Tatum.
Of the few to mention that. The defense is all over. Yeah. Well, they both have good defensive teams, wouldn't you say?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
The Celtics, Robert Williams is one of the best defensive centers in the league. He's a shot blocker down low. He can stop a lot of people. Jayson Tatum and Jaylen Brown are also very good perimeter defenders when needed at that position. They also have Marcus Smart, who's also very elite. Klay Thompson.
But they're all young. All young on Boston. That's why it may be too soon for them.
Yeah, I think Boston will eventually make it. I think they will win a title. Maybe not this year, but eventually.
Warriors, Tatum's only 23.
Yes. They're very young. The Warriors, they can win another. I wouldn't mind them. They've only been relevant recently, the past decade. So, I mean, you got to give them props for where they do good.
Boo.
They built a dynasty. Can't blame them for doing success.
Well, I only got one question. What happened to Kevin Durant?
He got injured and didn't play good.
For 2 years.
Yep.
Imagine if he didn't move for a trade.
Good point.
Oh, yeah, they would definitely have won another. They would have probably won back-to-back-to-back.
They may have done a quad-peat, not a three-peat.
That's true.
But I'm about these teams that can get two or three in a row because it's so hard to do.
I know, I agree with that.
Not everybody does it. And I understand personally, we root for certain teams. I got no skin in the game. I'm unlike Smoking Jim. I don't bet on these teams. So.
I like Tampa Bay. Back to back to back.
That's called a three-peat.
I wouldn't mind them winning. I'd just rather have seen the Rangers make it first.
Hey, this is about, on my show, it's about opinions and a few facts from Smoking Jim. Only a few.
But yeah, the NBA is going well. Hope to see either or team win. I don't want to mind. If it goes to a game seven, that's just more excitement to watch. I mean,
well, you're pro owner. They make extra money, so you're good. I understand that.
Either way, it works out.
Great points. Thanks, A2.
No problem.
All right, we're going to come up next with On Location. Great logo by A2. Tony from Chick-fil-A, Smoking Jim, he got a boxing question for you. Buster Douglas or Sugar Ray, who you picking?
For one fight, nobody beats Buster Douglas. The Buster Douglas that beat Mike Tyson, but the Buster Douglas that fought Evander Holyfield and folded up in the second round, anybody could have beat him. So yeah. Sugar Ray.
Gee. We got a double answer for Tony from Chick-fil-A. Chuck McElroy, Chief, great points by all. Amy's still looking for the Pirate game. She says no score for Pirates or St. Louis. Ralph put in some wisdom on I don't know who the Maulers are in Pittsburgh because they don't play here, but they're 1-8. I question the veracity of a Pittsburgh team that plays in Birmingham. Just saying.
And only wins one game.
Just saying. On location, Smoke and Jim, I got an announcement for you.
Yes!
September 24th, we're going to be announcing boxing for Christopher Ralph in Southside. So he loves us after we did the one show with him. Can't talk enough about us. And then we got to look for Jim Frio and tell him the date there, what, September 3rd or something?
Yeah, I think so.
Looks like we'll be back. Nick, mark your calendar. Monsville Prison.
I'll take off that day just
West
for you.
West Virginia.
Because it was 3 months in advance you're giving me. So
September
sure
3rd.
I could, sure I could do it. The 3rd?
Sorry. Yeah, I think. Okay. Smoke and Jim posted it. He never reads anything, so he just saw Frio and Mike Murray.
Okay.
He posted it. I liked it, so... He told us we'd be doing their next fight. Glad we got that. That's some on-location stuff. Have another couple people reaching out to do some shows. Just did a Talking Machine show on location with Nick on Saturday. Who would think the Talking Machine show would branch out? But Mike Lasovich, that owns the Forge, and he owns a great winery. Wow. He's a retired Marine for 40 years. He does a Veterans Wellness Day. He did it last year with Jessica Lee singing, and I just hung out there and met him, and he called me up, said, hey, could you interview all of our vendors and even some vets? I said, here's what I'll do. Whoever you bring up to me, I'll interview. So he did. Awesome. They had musicians there. Jessica Lee sang. Another group called Crash Army. Shout out to Corey Barr. He was the lead singer and guitar player. They played so loud that I couldn't hear on some of my interviews because they didn't have a sound engineer at the time. But we worked through it. Nick's going to come up with a great show with that because he said our mics worked. He let me listen to a sample. So on location worked there. And then now I got three other people. Reginald's Coffee, who I mentioned, you know, in the schoolhouse there. I told Matt that I want to interview him on some Wednesday after 2 o'clock. So he said, sure, come on in. So my Talking Machine show's veering off a little bit, so we'll have some on locations. And I appreciate everybody giving them the great feedback, including Jim. We did a Jim Ellenbogen. He wanted to do a show on guns in America. And check it out. We did it last Wednesday, and we're getting great feedback on it. We just tried to be honest about guns and the Second Amendment. I believe in it. And I want people to go back in history that our forefathers never thought we'd have 330 million people, and they didn't know we'd have technology like this and drones and weapons. So I want to go back to the weapons they had because that's what they were talking about. I believe everybody should have at least one musket or one for each family member. And if you like cannons, you can have as many cannons and cannonballs in your yard. So I'm going back in history. So if somebody wants to shoot 30 people with a musket, with our technology and guns, we can use them with the police. So that's what I have to say. We're going to come back and we're just going to shoot the breeze on some conversation in sports, like a final what's on your mind with each person here if they want to bring something up. Since Smoke and Jim got so many things on his mind, we're going to go with him first. You want to talk about any subject? Or?
Yeah, I just have a question for Nick.
Yes.
You had mentioned in your segment that the Pirates was on a losing streak. What kind of losing streak are they on?
Hold it. We got to put up the negative disclaimer.
No, I was just asking.
For
I didn't
Smoke
know.
And Jim Frazier.
No, I didn't know. What kind of question is it? I didn't know they were on a losing streak. How many
well,
games?
Hold it. Oh, if no. He gambles against the Bucks all the time. Think about it, fans. He would know how long their losing streak is. So he's like a lawyer. No offense to my lawyer friends. They ask questions they know the answer to.
Yeah.
And if he says six, Smoke and Jim knows it.
What? I definitely said eight.
Huh?
Two against the Tigers, three against the Braves, two against the Cardinals.
Seven.
That's seven. Okay, so I was
couldn't you figure that out?
Oh, they sound
you
like
either
the
won
Maulers.
250 or lose 250.
They're like the Pittsburgh Maulers.
No, they played more games. You know they played
they won
60
more than
games.
One game, yeah.
They played 60 games, buddy.
What kind? But you asked what kind of losing streak they're on.
Yeah.
Is there a type of losing streak?
No, I didn't know. You said I didn't know they were on.
Are they on a good losing streak?
They were hot there for a while.
That's what I'm saying. That's why I'm sad.
Okay.
Because they beat good West Coast teams. at least once in a series, they swept the Dodgers, and then they're like, oh, the Tigers, they're tough. The bottom of the AL Central, they're tough. Two games against the Tigers, can't handle them. Let's lose both. And then a Braves team that struggled earlier in the year, let's give them confidence as they go on a double-digit winning streak, because that's what the Pirates do.
They're trying to win their 13th game, Smoking Jim, the Braves, tonight.
Yeah.
Well, you read a lot of books. Is there any way to reverse the curse?
Yeah. Here's what I'll say.
You put this a cannonball.
No.
Put a cannonball in your yard.
Let me explain it in simple terms that you'll understand. There's no curse unless you believe in a curse.
I believe.
So if you're simple that you believe in a curse that's not based on facts, you always have the curse, but guess what? The team doesn't even know there's a curse.
He's just happy.
The Guinness Book of World Record knows when they went 20 straight years without
a winning
record.
They didn't call it the Sid Bream curse.
They just put them in the
They said it was the longest streak in professional sports.
Yeah, Sid Bream sounds like a curse to me.
Smoking Jim, you're a simple man, so we're just talking simple things. If you believe there's a curse.
You think the Steelers have been cursed because Mike Tomlin's been the head coach for so long now.
Well, after they got rid of Santonio Holmes, the curse was on, yeah. They ain't went to the Super Bowl since.
Trapper Tom says, Ralph Williams, you're the guy still following? Ha ha. Trapper Tom, that was hilarious.
Oh, no.
And he's following us. So we appreciate the things going back and forth, but can't beat that.
Can't follow the Maulers.
Yeah, and Smoking Jim, thanks for adding something to the show.
Are you and I going to Birmingham? Let's take a Smoking. I'll take a trip.
If he drives,
we'll do it on location.
Only if he drives.
Yeah, Smoking Jim and I'll document the whole thing.
You get no cameras from me. You can use your phone setup. Use that phone setup.
Can you imagine Smoking Jim with cannons in his front yard, by the way? Being that old guy in Monroeville. Get off my lawn!
No, here's what I can imagine.
I'm going to have a musket.
He wants a musket because he'd never fire it. He don't even know how you fire it.
That's true.
No, the reason why he says that is because they're actually incredibly hard to fire. You got to clean out the barrel first, then you got to load in these giant,
How do you white guys know all this stuff?
We read books, buddy. We read history books, man. Didn't you get an education at Gateway?
No, hey, Smoking Jim, you know how I do it? I'm so old, I grew up in 1776. That's my story. Wow. Nick, you want to add any logic or any stories that make no sense?
Well, I think I added some non-logic.
We'll go to A2 then. You got any other subject you want to talk about except cruising in your white vet?
I don't know. I can't really.
You stumped.
I've been stumped on, I don't know.
All right. Here's what I appreciate. An honest 21-year-old.
I got something back in now that I'm thinking.
You back?
Okay. Yeah, I'll come back.
I tried to give a pause for him.
I'm sad.
Way to go.
I'm sad that the Warriors are winning because I don't like super teams. Even though I picked the Dodgers to win the World Series in 2020 against the Rays because I didn't want the Rays to win because I'm kind of a Yankees fan on the American League side. So I might be a hypocrite. Well, now we're bringing that up. I don't want the Warriors to win.
I have to butt in on you.
Yeah.
You're not like a hypocrite.
I am one. No, that's the definition. That's the exact definition of a hypocrite.
How about my Tampa Bay?
No, I don't want the Lightning to win either.
Smoking Jim, I have to agree. This is one of the few times on Pittsburgh Sportsline. Sorry, Nick. I want Tampa Bay to have a three-peat because I noticed they coasted through the season. They didn't really care because they already won two in a row. And then how did they come on in the playoffs and look pretty good?
Well, they're winning still.
They won to get to here.
They did win to get there.
And you know you got to win 16 games, unlike Smoking Jim.
But I'm on the opposite of A2. I despise.
What are you against him now?
No.
What happened?
We're still friends. We're good. We're good.
I'm questioning.
Here's what I mean. I hate when, I'm a big proponent on championships and doing the necessary things to win games and having those major regrets when you don't win. If a team that we lost to in the playoffs, any Pittsburgh team lost to in the playoffs, goes and wins the championship, I feel terrible. My mom used to tell me this, and a couple other sports fans of mine were like,
I'll beat them up.
Well, at least we lost to the champions. My mindset is we could have been the champions.
Good point.
So that's what happened with the Pirates in 2014.
I
got to
interrupt
the Giants
you. With the other point. If they beat us and become champions, I don't feel as bad.
No, I do, because it could have
been
us.
No, I don't, because we lost.
It could have been us.
No, we lost.
No, I get that we lost, but it could have been us.
Let me emphasize again.
If the Penguins would have won, I predicted they'd make it to the conference finals. And guess what happened? They lost to the team that made it to the conference finals. Yeah. If the Rangers were good enough to get to the finals, the Penguins certainly could have beat that team in the second round to get to the finals.
I disagree with all y'all.
So, not a big fan of that.
I disagree.
So, I celebrated, despite the. I don't have feelings against the Lightning. They've just already won twice. And
hold it.
Colorado's
you talked last week about feelings, even on YouTube. You sang.
I did.
Don't have feelings, and now you admitted you don't have feelings.
Yeah, I don't. Yeah, exactly. I don't.
No, you're okay.
I don't feel one way or the other toward the Lightning or the Avalanche because they're not the Penguins, so that's fine. But like, if the Lightning already won already, that's why I'm kind of rooting for the Avalanche because like, let them win, you know, now because why not? But I'm glad the Rangers aren't in, and I was celebrating when Tampa Bay came back and won the series because I am not a fan of teams that beat my team making it all the way because it could have been us, and that's the champion's mindset in my opinion. VIP bonus. There you go.
That's a winner.
I got to disagree with you. Nick, we're still friends, like you preface all that.
Sure.
You know, with A2. We're still friends, but I disagree completely because we lost. And if they were good enough to win and then they become champs, I'm happy for them, and we lost to the champ.
Wouldn't you have been happier, though, if we would have won the championship being in that
That
same
goes
position?
Without saying.
Okay.
I'm a fan who's disgruntled.
All right.
And I'm not a dreamer and schemer.
So you feel would you feel better or worse if that team that beat us went on to win? Better
yeah,
or worse?
Yeah, I already said
you'd
that.
You'd feel better.
Yeah.
Than if they didn't win.
The Flurry curse.
Yeah. I feel better if they became champions and we lost to the champs.
I will say I do, since you bring up the curse, I do believe in curses in sports.
Yes!
I do believe
my
in
man!
Do you believe that the Sid Bream incident was a curse? Do you think the Sid
Bream
years ago?
So it was before my time too, and I know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, but
what's
you
was that curse?
So baseball.
We're running out of time, but right. Make it quick because this is nonsense.
The Pirates lost in 1992 in the championship series to make it to the World Series because one of the slowest guys in baseball scored, and Barry Bonds could not throw him out from the outfield with one of the best arms in baseball.
And
the Pirates didn't make the playoffs since 92 until 2013.
After they backstabbed Sid Bream, who was on the team the year before.
I don't know if that's a curse. I do believe
there you go. See? No, that's all I wanted
to make a good point.
I wanted to hear a good point.
Because I believe in the Babe Ruth curse.
Yes. Yeah, I do too.
I believe in this terrible towel curse, they say, if you stomp on it.
I believe in that because we've witnessed it.
It's more superstition than a curse.
And then Jim Ellenbogen wants to chime in. When it comes to the Pirates, reality is instead of rousing my hopes, it arouses my memory.
Oh, wow.
Think deep on that, Smokin'. Till next week, thanks all of you for watching it out. Thanks for my catcher in Little League and Pony League, Greg Kirby, who got cataract surgery like Smokin' Jim, who says he can see now, but we don't know how good it is. You just have to drive with him once. Amy said, Pirates are losing 3-0, Nick.
Oh, that's good.
Please stay Joey strong.